Warning: this review contains discussions of abuse, suicide, and self-harm. Some clips chosen from the film may be disturbing to viewers. Listener and viewer discretion is advised.
Deadlights Pod.
Welcome to the Deadlights Podcast. I'm your host, Sam.
And I am Leslie. And we're bringing you another week of horror.
This week is definitely a horrific week, to say the least, I would say. Honestly, to start off, we're still processing definitely what we just saw, because it was quite torturous, to say.
It was torturous. This one hurt, you guys. This one hurt.
It really did. I guess we should introduce the movie. Just get straight into this.
Okay.
We watched Martyrs from 2008, written and directed by Pascal Laugier. A young woman's quest for revenge against the people who kidnapped and tormented her as a child leads her and a friend, who is also a victim of child abuse, on a terrifying journey into a living hell of depravity.
Oh boy, yeah. Was it.
For not only them, for us as well. At a certain point, it was a movie about torture and felt torturous.
I hurt. My body and my mind hurt. My soul, my heart. This one was tough, Sam.
It was a really tough movie.
It was tough.
It was so intense.
I'm drinking. I'm drinking and I don't drink.
We both had to pour out a little bit for this one.
Jesus Christmas. Oh, God.
Yeah, so very visceral reaction, as you can probably tell, to this movie. And just to preface, both Leslie and I had to walk out at a certain point to take a break, because it was...
I cried multiple times.
Yeah.
I hurt, Sam.
It hurt. It really hurt.
Jesus. Oh, God. Well, but there's a lot to say.
There's a lot to talk about.
So let's just get into
it. Let's get into it for sure. Let's start with the can.
Uh-huh.
How this movie was made. I mean, I guess putting aside all the intense stuff that we saw, it is a very well-made movie.
It is.
For sure. Very, very pretty movie, too.
Well acted. I would also like to say.
Wow.
Oh, my God.
That was part of, I think, probably having this reaction, this intense reaction to this movie is coming from, too, because it felt very real, you know, a lot of really intense. I mean, the entire movie was intense and relentless. And we felt like we were there between like the handheld shots and the close ups and the very intense practical effects, too, that were really good and hard to see. And the acting as well. Like, this movie was so well acted that it felt like we were, we were really there.
I'm hoping they received help after, you know, shooting these scenes, because it felt relentless to us.
Mm-hmm.
So I can only imagine the creative part behind making a movie. I don't know how one can act these torturous scenes without breaking some part of you,
mm-hmm.
because that's what this movie was about.
Mm-hmm.
Fucking breaking our spirits.
Will we ever be free from this? Yeah, sure.
And they did such a good job by writing the script, the editing of it being just these shots, again, this word relentless, just over and over. And you're just like, you're hoping they won't go there. You know, we saw this scene and we're like, okay, this is as far as we go, right? Always ending the question with, right? We're not going to go there, right?
They wouldn't do that to us.
They, of course not. No. At one point, I was just like, this movie hates us. Hates us. They are showing us the most horrific inner workings of a human being and how that affects. I guess I'm talking about the meat. I'm so sorry.
No, it does go along with the filmmaking and the acting too. Like, you're right.
They did a fantastic job and it hurts. Yep. That's what hurts about it.
It's interesting because at the beginning of the movie, they set this really high bar of intensity and seriousness. And then they somehow continued to elevate it all the way until the movie stopped. Like, it just kept going up and up and up in intensity. And that does go along with how they structured the story and the the pace at which they unfolded it. I love, really, the script is great.
It's great.
It's a great, greatly written story, and how they interpreted the script too was just great too. They left us in those moments that we did not want to be left in very well.
Oh God.
Very well. And yes, that does, I think too, go back to the performances that we're getting from these people. The two main girls, and then ultimately the final girl, the first girl, Lucy, because we kind of, that's where we start, her escaping from her torturers. And then it's kind of becomes a story about figuring out what her trauma is and her journey to get revenge on these people that did this to her with the help of her friend, Anna. So she is like deeply haunted. Like, the performance is,
she's
like
tortured.
Yeah.
Absolutely tortured from her past. She's suffering from PTSD enough to hallucinate. And she is seeing this supernatural being, which is a girl that she couldn't rescue that was also being tortured.
And how they structure the movie is, we don't know actually, is this real or is this just in her head? Because she does have these cuts on herself.
And wow, I just want to say, they had a contortionist as this being, right? Because like, that didn't seem CGI.
No.
Not a lot. No, not at all.
I don't think so.
Yeah, no. So this person was like acting and they were creepy.
Creepy.
Creepy. And it's just like another element as to how this movie was so well done.
I think we should probably just get into the meat.
Okay.
Because we're already going there anyway.
Oh my God.
They're well paired though. Like, I think that, you know, we'll get to the cook eventually too, but like, how they're pairing what we're seeing with the things that we're talking about is very well paired, because we're talking about suffering, really. We're talking about, at first, it is kind of this like relationship, toxic somewhat relationship that we're seeing between Lucy and Anna, because how Lucy is processing her trauma or not processing her trauma is manifested in this monster that she's seeing. And then ultimately it's pushing her to take revenge on people. Anna is there all the time to support whatever she needs to get through this trauma.
She's an enabler in the sense that her caregiving aspects are just, to take care of this being.
And it kind of poses the question of like, how do you deal with your trauma? Is it healthy or not? And then how does a partner deal with the trauma too? When you're in a relationship, you bring whatever baggage it is into it too. So how does that partnership either help or hurt this trauma that you're going through?
Is that orange juice you have?
Yeah.
Is it for her?
Yeah.
wasn't working because it drove someone to commit murder. And then now Anna is having to absolutely take all the repercussions of allowing this person to commit murder.
Mm-hmm. And enabling it too. She went to the house after Lucy found the people and killed their entire family. They stay in the house for a long time, and it isn't until the mom wakes up, which is another twist in the movie, Anna decides to maybe do something to, you know, break this cycle and help this woman.
It hurts even more because Anna doesn't quite believe Lucy.
Mm-hmm.
We find that out.
So you never believe me? Enough. So you believe I'm insane too, just like the doctors.
And then, you know, like, here comes the SWAT team or whatever.
That was like such a weird moment. I was like, wait, people coming in to clean this up? What the fuck?
I was just like, what?
Yeah, a SWAT team comes in that we never see before, never been hinted at.
Nope. It's another fucking twist.
It's another twist, yeah. Oh, shit. This is a, like, this is like an organization of torturers.
Lucy Duran actually escaped from us 15 years ago. Correct? After 15 years, the child found her. I was impressed by her tenacity. As for the rest, Lucy's just a victim. You lock someone in a room with no light. Soon, they begin to suffer. Then you feed that suffering. Slowly, methodically, systematically, coldly, for a long time. Yet everyone's a victim. Martyrs are very rare. They are exceptional beings. They withstand paralyzing pain, young lady. They can survive total deprivation. They carry all the sins of the world. They transcend themselves completely. Do you understand? They are transfigured.
The motivation behind this organization is to figure out the truth that's beyond death through torture. And yeah, they're very scientific. It's crazy. It's
tapping into the psychology of death.
Mm-hmm.
You know, of just having that fascination of the process of one slowly losing their life. And I mean, it is a subject in which we should study. Just because it's scary doesn't mean that we shouldn't figure how it works in a way.
Mm-hmm.
But the way that they were torturing people, kidnapping them to accomplish these studies is really scary.
Mm-hmm.
Because also we have some medicine existing only because people were being tortured. Like, that is the truth.
We tried everything, even with children, and we've proven that it's women that are much more responsive to transfiguration.
It's sick.
It's scary to think about.
It is so sad.
And then
I'm going to take a big ass gulp of my whiskey.
Take a gulp. Because then we see everything that Lucy was saying, you know, is completely confirmed. Because then we see Anna go through the torture process and we see the entire thing. The second half of this movie, maybe the last, I don't know, half hour or so, was torture. It really was so torture.
Bad.
It was crazy. We saw the entire process of her being broken down and then going through the transfiguration. It was hard. It was really hard.
It was, and
that's when it was like, going back to the meat, when you put yourself in this kind of toxic relationship that is based in trauma, both people end up taking on that trauma. And the person who maybe didn't bring that in, and if you're not dealing with it in a healthy way and you're just enabling it, you will also get trapped in that trauma. Mm-hmm. And we saw her get trapped, and she became a martyr. Yes. In the end, she gave them the truth behind life and death. But then the old woman just ended up shooting herself in the head. So what does that really say? Was it even worth it to get someone there at all?
And I love that we don't know the truth.
Mm-hmm.
We never hear it. We just see it being whispered. And so it allows us to fill that in with whatever the fuck our fears are. And let me just tell you, I've been living my life just like, you know, being like, ooh, I can do whatever I want. And this movie made me afraid again of stepping out of my house.
Have you seen it then? The other world?
Made me so afraid also of death.
Mm-hmm.
It put you there.
Mm-hmm.
There were moments in where I, like I mentioned earlier, we're like, oh, we're not going to step there. We're not going to go there. This movie better not go there. And then it puts you there. And then it keeps getting worse. And one of the moments where I was just like, oh, okay, cool. Yes, we've gotten really terrible things in the beginning of the movie. And we're not getting a lot of the torture scenes. We just get a bit of just like what's happening. And it fucking sucks. But they didn't push it. Until then, this girl's having to go through it. And it fucking sucked.
They showed it.
We had the mother figure, quote unquote, coming in, feeding her, and then really just like absolutely not being compassionate, caring at all. And then the dad figure would come in to, you know, discipline her.
Mm-hmm.
And it just got worse and worse. It broke me.
Yeah.
It broke me.
You felt it. You felt it. You felt the breaking. You felt the suffering. And it sucked because at the end, I mean, they break her and then they skin her. Everything except her face, which is quite a shocking thing to see.
I walked away.
That's when you walked out, for sure.
That's when I walked out.
Then they kept cutting back to it. And then... That's when I had to walk
out. Yeah, you walked out and I stepped in. Yeah. And I'm crying.
We traded off.
You literally were like in the kitchen and you're like looking at me and I'm fucking crying. And I'm like, bro, this fucking sucks, yeah, man. This sucks. I want out of here. How many times did I say that?
Mm-hmm.
I want out. Mm-hmm. I need this to be done. I want out. And it kept going. Fucking kept going.
Well, let's get to the cook because that's kind of what the what we're talking about, I guess, is this idea of taking us on a wild ride that we can't escape and we want to escape so many times, which Lucy and Anna did too. They just wanted to escape their situations.
Mm-hmm.
And ultimately, we were all put through a situation that we all wanted to escape. And they didn't let us do it for a really long time. When it was the end of the movie, we both took a massive sigh of relief.
You'll be all right. Your suffering is almost over. There's only one more stage.
I think in order for you to make a movie that evokes so much, like pulling so much from you, and it's not just like because... we're watching a violent scene.
No.
Mm-mm. It's because of the way that they have also interlaced this human aspect of how it would feel for someone to go through that. And it just reminds us of just like, we're all human, you know, like take care of yourself, take care of others. There's a balance to things though, you know, you have to take care of yourself first. And then if there's any room, take care of another person. But that other person also needs to also follow the same of take care of yourself.
I completely agree with you that it almost isn't even the things that we're seeing. It's the emotions that we're feeling because we care about these characters. And I think that that does really come from the performances for sure. So well done. And then the writing and the story that these filmmakers are telling. So the pairing of the meat and the can to make this cook is just, I think, great. And where we have movies like Saw and the Saw series, where it is arguably more torture, physical torture, that you are actually seeing in those movies, but nothing that I've seen in any of those movies felt as bad as these, because I actually cared about this person. And I like you said, felt in some ways what they were going through.
Just let go. And if I can, will you be there? Yes, I miss you.
I thought it was just like, it was such a well-structured story because there was little twists along the way. You know, obviously starting with this kind of mystery of why are these people the way they are? Because the opening of this movie actually is kind of its own little story. You know, we start with her escaping from these people, and then she's in the orphanage, then her meeting this friend, and them, you know, presumably helping each other and supporting each other as through their traumas as kids. And then we have the introduction of like this supernatural element too in there, of Lucy as a child sees this specter, you know, sees this entity haunting her. And we're both like, wait a second, this is a ghost movie?
Yeah.
I was like, wait, I didn't know either. I was like,
that's when I like hugged the pillow and I like became a little ball because that person, that contortionist, they were scary.
Yeah,
they were creepy.
Yeah,
I didn't like it.
It was like, oh shit, this is it's like a ghost or demon movie, maybe. Yeah. So it was kind of that was definitely a twist of like, this is supernatural.
The movie could have ended there.
Yeah, and then it kind of that was the title, and I was like, oh okay, that does a really good job of setting up the entire movie, but it is its own little like story structure in there.
When it's revealed that she is suffering from PTSD, it is just awful.
Yes.
It is so easy to create a victim, young lady. So easy. The mental trauma starts to break them. And that small, easily opened crack makes them see things that don't exist in our world.
And you're like, okay, this is where the movie's going to end.
Yeah, this is what this is about. Right?
No. I
thought there were going to be some sort of cult. Like, I thought there was going to be like a demon cult or something. And
Hereditary. Hereditary. Oh, my God.
And I thought we were going to go there. Yeah, I thought we were going to go full supernatural.
But, yeah.
No.
No, we didn't.
No.
We got even more real.
We got the realist of the real. Or, oh, no, these are people straight up just torturing people. Scientifically down to like a technique, and they have a purpose for it too. And
like, these people have jobs. The people that are torturing this poor woman,
yeah,
it's a job.
Anna Asawi became a martyr. Let us take a moment to pay our respects. In our 17 years of research, Anna is only the fourth person to have attained that stage, and the first, yes my friends, the first one to have reported what she has seen.
Awful people exist.
And that too.
These motherfuckers exist. Oh, God. It's so scary.
There's a lot of scary things about this movie. And I think we should probably just get to the thrill. because I mean, it's wild. This movie is something else, just to say the least. But at least within the thrill, the first half scare is definitely completely different than the second half scare, because the first half we are dealing with a supernatural being, we think at least, that Lucy is carrying around, like this naked woman, contortionist woman. Very, they just kind of hint at it at the beginning, but then when she, you know, we see her, she's very scary. Yeah, and then we realize that, oh no, that is the woman that Lucy saw when she escaped and she couldn't save her. And she's being haunted by the fact that she couldn't save her. And then we're like, okay, so this could still be somewhat supernatural. But then the second half of this movie is the reveal that no, that actually, these people, these torturers can get into your trauma and create monsters that you see. And they actually can like tinker with your brain to make you see things and make you hallucinate.
Break you.
And break you.
Your friend Lucy, what was her vision? Did she see things that wanted to hurt her?
A dead girl.
I knew it.
So no, it wasn't a supernatural being at all. It was just these crazy torturers, which for Anna is revealed when she finds the secret room in the house that they've been staying in the whole time that leads down to the torture chamber.
And we're just like, no.
Like, oh, oh.
No.
And she finds someone that they've been torturing for a while, it seems like.
And you're like, oh, okay, this is going to be barbarian. You know, it's just going to get out. She's going to be fine. No. No. No, we don't get out.
She tries to help this woman who's got this,
oh my god,
this torture blindfold over her head that's been stapled into her skull. Anna's the caretaker, so she stays there to try to help her.
Mm-hmm.
Which is also part of her she should have left so long ago.
It was awful.
She couldn't help herself.
Ay, this movie, Sam, fucking hurt. Every element hurt.
It really just kept getting worse. It kept getting way worse.
What's the song? I hurt myself today just to see if I still bleed.
Johnny Cash, why?
God. Wow. It's a cover, but he did sing it, and he sang it good.
Yeah. I mean, I would say, going back to the thrill, this movie was horrifying. This movie was scary as hell. I mean, it was tense. It was a great, you know, mystery of what we were actually ultimately getting to. Mm-hmm. And it really, it was scary to watch. Like, it was scary to see some of those things, and especially when we got to the second half where it was real torture. It was scary to see those things and to see a person go through that. It was scary on a lot of levels, which I think was kind of really smart about this movie, because at first we thought we were going to be scared by a ghost.
Yeah.
But no, we got twisted around. We're scared by people.
Or a demon.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a demon.
I'd take a demon over this any day.
God damn.
No, it was the people. It was such a good switch of form and switch of...
But it was seamless. Mm-hmm. Seamless. Mm-hmm. It wasn't just like, oh, these are two different movies.
Right.
No, they did a fantastic job interlacing every element that they introduce. And that is when you can have multiple storylines, multiple characters that are introduced in a strategic way, where you're just not like, who the fuck is this person, you know? Which we've seen a lot of those films this season. So to get one that shook the living fuck out of us, this is the scariest movie I have ever seen.
It is really intense.
Besides another one where it was about the black market and kidnappings and murders being committed to be sold in the black market. That movie terrified me as well.
That's fair. Yeah. I agree with you. I mean, it's got to be one of the most effective movies that we've watched. I mean, probably ever. And exactly puts you in the feelings that it's setting out to put you in.
Mm-hmm.
And just does it in such a wild way. Like, we were just on such a crazy ride in that movie.
I'm still broken. I'm still processing.
It's crazy. Like, well, I mean, let's get to the ride. Yeah. Just the final ride.
Yeah.
I mean, we're already talking about it. Whoa. Roller coaster of emotions. Roller coaster of a story. And just, I guess, really nothing I have ever seen before.
People ignore the existence of suffering. That's how our world sees it. Yet everyone's a victim.
I don't know if I want you to see this movie. I want you to, but also at the same time, I don't want to recommend anything that's gonna fucking fuck you up.
Mm-hmm. You got to be really prepared to see this. I mean, neither of us had seen this movie.
Take it like shrooms. When people recommend shrooms, they're like, you got to make sure that you're in the right headspace.
Yeah.
And with, you know, a like-minded group. Those are the two advices before taking shrooms.
Yeah, for sure.
This movie is very much like that.
Yeah.
Don't see it alone. And also, do it when you're in a good headspace.
Yeah.
Please. Yeah. That's all we ask.
See
then
it with
you
caution.
Can see it. Yeah.
The point of this podcast is to get people to watch horror. And this one is definitely a proceed with caution. If you think that you can really sit with this kind of stuff, then I guess try it out. It's intense. It's really, really wild. It's hard to get through. But it's also like really fucking good.
You have never walked away from a movie.
Never. Never
you
once.
You have never stood away and not seen the completion of a scene.
I couldn't. I and you're right. I usually can handle it. But this was so emotionally and physically taxing that I was like, I know what they're going to do, but I gotta walk out right now.
I at least pace around. I get up, you know, like I cover my face. I, you know, scream, get on top of the couch. Like I do it all. I did it all for this film as well.
Mm-hmm.
And you walked away for the first time.
Yeah.
I do want to also say, in regards to maybe the can, that this movie was made in 2008. You said that in the beginning. But I want to say that nowadays, at least the filmmaking in the United States is very much this. Of, you know, and this is what French filmmaking were doing in the early 2000s.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I feel like we're barely allowing ourselves to taste, to like tell these kind of like storytelling.
Mm-hmm.
Because, oh God, like it's torture. It's torture.
Martyrs from 2008. God damn. Okay, well, let's get to these Smashed Pumpkins.
I don't know. Man.
This is crazy. This is crazy because, like, right when the movie ended, I was like, "That was too much. I can't do it. This is too much." But now I'm like, "Do I love this movie?" This is crazy. It's crazy.
It's insane.
Do you have a number? Because
I think I have a number too, but I don't know what it's going to say about me.
I also have the same feeling.
Do you want to say it at the same time?
Yeah, we got to do it.
One, two, three. A five.
It's a five. What the fuck?
Are we demented?
Yes.
I think this...
It's the first five of the season, first of all.
Congratulations. Congratulations,
Martyrs. You fucking did it. First five of the season. Wow. Wow. But I mean, honestly, it's got the case. Like, there's nothing in any of these categories that I can knock them for. Like, they really created a true horror experience for us to go through. A true, true horrifying experience.
It's going to take me weeks to not think about this movie. Yeah. But I'll have a new obsession. I've been obsessing about things, so here we go.
I would say maybe don't watch this movie.
No, I'm not going to watch it ever again, but I will continue to think about it.
That's true.
The other movie from our season one? No, 31 Days of Horror.
Wow, even before season one.
Right? Raw?
Oh, yeah, that was Raw.
That is not on here. No, tell me Raw isn't in the bucket again. Oh.
It might be.
No.
Was it 31 days? Was it part of the 31 days? I can't remember.
I just remember it was just you and I was happy because I was pacing around. I almost threw up. So, like, that was another visceral. Mm-hmm. But before that, something that evoked the same kind of, like, humanity is broken was Prisoners.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
That was torturous, but this took it to, like, infinity and beyond.
Infinity and fucking beyond. It really does deserve the five. Because as much as we hated feeling those things, like, that's exactly what they wanted us to feel. And, I mean, like, it was a great... It was shot so well. It was paced so well. The performances were so good. Like, I don't really know how to fault the movie because it achieved exactly what it wanted to achieve. And we were scared the whole time.
This is the first movie that really made me feel like I was seeing someone die.
Yeah.
And we've seen so many people. I mean, oh my God, that sounds like a terrible statement to say.
You're right, though. We've seen a lot of people die.
We've seen a lot of people die, but it's just all make-believe.
Yeah.
And we know that. So, like, we know how it's made. So then this movie to evoke the feeling of death, it showed us when we were leaving.
When I was standing over there, that's what I was thinking. I was like, it's just a movie. I was just trying to remind myself, it's just a movie.
As I'm like fucking crying over there on the couch.
Yeah.
You're like, you okay?
You take it to the end. Yeah, rough.
God.
But wow. Holy fucking shit, y'all.
We're demented. The fact that you and I.
We knew. I mean. And that five, again, comes with caution. Please proceed with this movie with caution. It is very intense.
It's a movie.
It's a movie. Don't forget. It's a fucking movie. Okay. Let's put Martyrs to bed, huh?
God damn, please. Jesus Christ. Also, fuck you, Tim. Fuck you for picking it out of the bucket.
You are...
Jesus.
You're never coming back to this podcast again.
No, you are.
No, but... you are.
Wow, what a movie.
But we're
going to
make you watch it. We're going to torture you, Tim.
Oh, hell no.
Oh, my God. Okay, let's see what we got.
Next. Is it me?
Go for it. Let's see what we got. Please pick something that's...
Nice.
A little
happy,
a little just not so
Nightmare
dark.
Before Christmas. Oh no, it's a fat one.
It's a fat one.
Oh God. Oh no, it's not.
Oh.
There's just a lot of writers.
Yep. We got a lot of those.
A homicidal turkey axes off college kids during Thanksgiving.
Okay, well, you know what? We asked for something way different, and we fucking got it. That would be Thanksgiving. A homicidal turkey. Okay, I can take that. I can take that. Thank you, Bucket. Thank you. Thank you.
Oh, my God.
You put a little relief in us.
Written by Jordan Donnie, Brad Schwarz, Kevin Schwartz, Anthony Wilson, and Grant Yaffe.
Wow. All right. Thanks.
Thanks, Killing.
Thanks, Killing.
Wow. Well, the horror gods are real.
The Bucket is having a little mercy on us.
Thank God. This time.
And from the same year, 2008.
2008. Well, we're
hot
gonna...
year. Hot Woo! Year for 2008. Wow.
It's an American film, I'm assuming.
I would assume right? so, too.
No one will ever make a movie like that. But, Whew. God. All right.
Well, thank you for going through this with us.
That was rough.
We're still processing it, and we will be for a while.
For the rest of our lives.
Rest of our lives. Let's get out of here.
Well, we have a phone number in which you can call and leave your amazing stories.
Your movie reviews. Please. Anything at all, really.
Anything. Yeah. At this point, we'll take it.
We'll take it.
We just don't say obscene things. Like, God damn it. How old are you? Two?
I don't know. As long as, I mean, it's funny. I'll take it.
2-year-olds don't say obscene things.
Yeah, definitely not.
8. Yeah.
2-year-olds don't say obscene things. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they're not like, fuck you, mom.
I don't know. Maybe.
God, I need to watch all the happy things in the world right
yeah,
now.
I really
Maybe
need
some
to.
Studio Ghibli or something.
Yeah.
Well,
you can call us at 773-669-6677.
I totally forgot what I was saying, but you can follow me on Instagram at Color Me Leslie.
And me at BP Pritchie T. You can follow us at the Deadlights Pod.
You can.
But until next time,
let's get spooky.
God, what the fuck? My brain.
I hurt so much.